October 4th, 1957. The then Soviet Union launches Sputnik into low Earth orbit, making it Earth's first artificial satellite. This Soviet accomplishment disappointed Americans, as 2 years prior, President Dwight D. Eisenhower announced that the United States was going to launch an artificial satellite ourselves. It wasn't until 4 months later that the U.S. launched their first satellite, Explorer 1, which was still after the Soviets had launched their second orbital, Sputnik 2.
Just over 3 years later, Soviet's Vostok 1 spacecraft took one full orbit around the Earth and returned safely to the ground, while carrying Soviet cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin, making him the first human to enter space. This beat the first American in space, Alan Shepard, by a month.
With Americans now frightened of the military implications of Soviet-occupied space, President John F. Kennedy urges America to focus its energies by declaring a national goal of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely back to Earth.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving a goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
4 years following, Soviet's Alexei Leonov becomes the first man to conduct an EVA, or extravehicular activity, with a 12-minute spacewalk. This, again, is before astronaut Ed White did America's first EVA, earning America the silver medal.
Over the next 18 months, however, the United States would perform 8 additional EVAs during the Gemini missions. These would go unmatched by the Soviets. These Gemini missions opened the door for the Apollo program to begin.
Apollo 1 tragically failed during a rehearsal when an electrical fire ignited and caused the destruction of the command module and the death of the 3 crewmen on board.
Successful Apollo missions followed, including Apollo 7, which was the first manned mission to be publicly televised. Apollo 8, the first manned mission to perform 10 lunar orbits. And Apollo 10, the first mission to test drive the lunar module around the moon.
The failure or success of these many missions set the groundwork for the moment that fulfilled past dreams, defied present limitations, and unlocked the future of possibilities. Apollo 11, man's first step onto the moon.
July 16th, 1969. Crew members Commander Neil Armstrong, Command Module Pilot Michael Collins, and Lunar Module Pilot Edwin Buzz Aldrin Jr. are strapped into their chairs awaiting the countdown for liftoff.
Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
The rocket taking the crew to the moon is Saturn V. This behemoth stood 363 feet tall. If placed on its side, it would stretch the entire length of a football field. The entire rocket doesn't make it to the moon. In fact, only a very small portion does. As each portion of the rocket becomes obsolete, it is jettisoned to reduce the mass of the spacecraft. The lowest section, called Stage 1, is providing the thrust needed to counter Earth's gravitational pull. This stage gets the spacecraft to a speed of 6,000 miles per hour, after which it is detached to reduce mass from the spacecraft. After stage 1 separation, stage 2 ignites. This stage accelerates the spacecraft to over 15,000 miles per hour. Once stage 2 has exhausted its fuel, it too is jettisoned and stage 3 is then fired. Stage 3 is not burnt to exhaustion. Instead, after burning for a couple minutes, stage 3 is shut down. This leaves the spacecraft at the correct distance and speed to remain in a stable Earth orbit. This pause allows the spacecraft to prepare for its final burn. This final burn must be precisely timed to escape Earth's gravity at the exact moment. It also sends the spacecraft aimed at where the moon will be in a few days' time. Imagine, for a moment, a quarterback throwing a pass to a receiver. Since the receiver is moving, he can't throw the ball at where the receiver currently is, or the receiver will run past and not catch the ball. Instead, the quarterback must throw the ball ahead of the receiver's path. If thrown correctly, the receiver and ball will reach the same point at the same time and the pass is complete. From this analogy, the ball is the spacecraft, the receiver is the moon, and the quarterback are NASA's calculations on when is the right time to perform the final burn. This is no easy calculation. The moon is orbiting over 250,000 miles away at a speed of 2,316 miles per hour. This is comparable to our quarterback standing in Philadelphia, needing to hit a 6-mile diameter target, moving at 6 miles per hour in Chicago. Just the smallest error in the throw would result in the football being far off path. The spacecraft can make small adjustments during its 3-day flight, but each adjustment costs fuel, and that is at limited supply. If the initial burn is drastically off, the spacecraft would have to expel too much fuel adjusting and be stranded in space. At the correct calculated moment, Apollo 11 Stage 3 rocket ignites. Once complete, this third stage is detached and releases the lunar module that was stored inside. Michael Collins pilots a service command module, called Columbia, to turn around and dock with a lunar module, called Eagle. Once complete, the astronauts now enjoy a weightless 72-hour flight to the moon.
The Moon. Real name, Luna. Earth's only natural satellite. Size, 2,160 miles across. Roughly the coast-to-coast distance across the United States. Luna orbits 238,855 miles from the Earth, and does so in 27 days. Luna takes the same amount of time to rotate once on its axis. Daytime surface temperature, 260 degrees Fahrenheit. Nighttime surface temperature, negative 280 degrees Fahrenheit. Gravitational pull of Luna is only 16.5% of Earth, due to lower mass. It is suggested that Luna formed out of the Earth, after a large collision, early in the formation of the solar system. July 20th, 1969.
After orbiting the moon about a dozen times, Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin transferred over to the lunar module and began their descent onto the moon.
The target is the Sea of Tranquility, a large, flat portion of the lunar surface, as determined by many earlier robots that had landed and surveyed the terrain. During the descent, the astronauts realized they were seeing landmarks about 4 seconds earlier than their computers indicated. This meant the computer had them landing too far west. Armstrong switched to semi-automatic control and attempted to right this ship.
Things got very tense as the adjustments consumed the limited fuel supply in the LEM. As the mission approached critical abort levels, NASA reminded the astronauts of their time remaining.
More forward, drift into the right a little. Ready? Down a half. 30 seconds. Forward, drift. Ready? Contact light. Okay, engine stop. APA at a descent. Auto descent. Control both auto descent, engine command override off. Engine arm off. 413 is in.
We copy you down, Eagle.
Listen, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
The astronauts both took some time to calm down after the landing, Buzz Aldrin electing to take communion privately.
July 21st, 1969. At 2:51 Universal Time, Neil Armstrong opened the hatch of the lunar module. 5 minutes later, Neil Armstrong becomes the first human to walk on the surface of another world. Neil took pictures and collected contingency samples. These were quick gatherings of moon dirt and rock that was put directly into his spacesuit's pocket. This was to ensure that even if the astronauts had to quickly evacuate the lunar surface for any reason, at least some lunar material would return with them. 25 minutes after Neil Armstrong emerged from the lunar module, Buzz Aldrin joins him. Magnificent desolation. Buzz Aldrin's poetic description of the moon's surface. Because of the highly reflective lunar surface, it's likely the stars in the sky were not visible to the astronauts through their helmets. This means all they saw was an endless field of white on the ground and an endless sky of black. Magnificent desolation. After making a lens change to the camera, the astronauts reveal a message for future moon visitors.
We'll leave the flag that's on the front.
This plaque is located behind the ladder of the lunar module landing gear. When the lunar module leaves the moon to rendezvous back with the command module, this base portion will be left behind, leaving the message forever on the moon. Over the next couple minutes, Neil Armstrong carefully navigates the terrain to better position the camera. Both then get to work on erecting the American flag, during which Columbia makes communication.
Columbia, this is Houston, reading your letter. Where are we? I guess you're about the only person around that doesn't have TV coverage of the scene.
That's all right, I don't mind that. How is it quality of the TV?
Oh, it's beautiful, Mike, really is. Yes, indeed. They've got the flag up now, and you can see the stars and stripes from our own
screen. Beautiful.
That was communication between Mission Control in Houston and Michael Collins, who remains in Command Module Columbia. Since the lunar module Eagle cannot fly all the way back to Earth on its own power, it must reattach itself to Columbia. This requires that someone remain back in the Columbia throughout the process. Imagine you took a vacation somewhere far away, only when you get there, everyone else goes to the vacation site and you are left staying with the car. This was the selfless responsibility of Michael Collins. Now, of course, while he waits, he's got a pretty good show of his own to watch. On the moon for about 30 minutes, Buzz demonstrates how he and Neil have become accustomed to moving around on the moon.
You do have to be kind of careful to keep track of where your center of mass is. Sometimes it takes about two or three phases to make sure that you set your feet underneath it.
Minutes later, the longest distance phone call in history takes place.
Roger, let's get both of you to be able to camera for us. Neil and Buzz, the President of the United States is in his office now and would like to say a few words to you, over.
Hello, Neil and Buzz. I'm talking to you by telephone from the Oval Room at the White House, and this certainly has to be the most historic telephone call ever made. I just can't tell you how proud we all are of what you do. For every American, this has to be the proudest day of our lives. And for people all over the world, I am sure they too join with America. In recognizing
become a part of mass birth. And as you talk to us from the Sea of Tranquility, it inspires us to redouble our efforts to bring peace and tranquility to Earth. For one priceless moment in the whole history of man, all the people on this Earth are truly one. One in their pride in what you have done, and one in our prayers that you will return safely to Earth.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's a great honor and privilege for us to be here representing not only the United States, but and our peace of all nations, and with interest and the curiosity and with the vision for the future. Honor for us to be able to participate here today.
And thank you very much, and I look forward, all of us look forward to seeing you on the Hornet on Thursday.
Look forward to that very much, sir.
For the remainder of their time on the moon, Neil and Buzz completed as many of the planned experiments and tests that they could. They gathered nearly 50 pounds of moon rock and dust, which later led to the discovery of three new minerals, one of which was named Armalcolite, an amalgamation of Armstrong, Aldrin, and Collins. They set up a retroreflector, a device that reflects light back to its source to accurately measure the distance to the moon using lasers, and a passive seismic experiment package used to measure moonquakes. They also left behind a memorial bag. This bag contained an Apollo 1 mission patch to honor the three astronauts that died in the fire, a golden olive branch, a traditional sign of peace, some Soviet medals of commemoration honoring cosmonauts Komarov and Gagarin, and a disc. This half-dollar-sized disc contains micro-printed recorded statements of leaders from more than 70 countries. 2.5 hours after setting foot onto the lunar surface, Neil and Buzz had done what they could and re-entered the lunar module for a well-deserved rest. 7 hours later, the Eagle reconnects with Columbia. After transferring all important cargo, Eagle is detached for one last time and is left orbiting the moon. Columbia burns its engines and sends the astronauts back towards Earth.
July 24th, 1969. At 16:51 Universal Time, the command module housing all three astronauts splashes down in the Pacific Ocean, and the Coast Guard rescue team, called Frogmen, were deployed to retrieve the astronauts. The Frogmen were ordered to stay in their wetsuits and to breathe from their tanks, even if out of the water, so not to breathe in any possible contaminants that may have come home from the moon. This precaution of moon contaminants continued for another 21 days, keeping the astronauts confined in isolation. It wasn't until August 10th that the astronauts were finally cleared to join civilization once again.
July 16th, 1969. Three astronauts left the planet to set foot on another world for the first time in human history. Even though the trip took only 8 days to complete, more than a decade worth of effort went into its success. The drive for space exploration led to new and better inventions that benefit us to this day. As we look into the future, we look further into space. Taking just one small step at a time, will lead to great, giant leaps for all mankind.